Truly all power, all glory, all honor belong to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And we are happy you have joined us. I hope you were here for the last hour. We were talking about hospitality, philoxenos, the love of strangers. To exercise hospitality is to be a lover of strangers. Yes. And we said that when hospitality is when strangers can feel the love of God through their interactions with the people of God. When strangers can feel the love of God through their interactions with the people of God. Mm. And I said earlier that all of us have many capacities where we are overseers. Mm-hmm. We're overseers of certain missions and ministries that God has given us. And so this is where it is for us. It's not just for people thinking about becoming the pastor of a church. No, it's for you. Mm-hmm. You're the overseer of your circle of friends. You're the one that's saved. You're the spiritual one. You're the spiritual one in your family. You're the overseer of your family's spirituality. You're the overseer of your family's reaching out to God. Or your family having spiritual strength. Mm-hmm. And so this is important for you as a attitude, a practice, a value, a principle. Amen. And so I told a story about one time I was in Northern California and I went into a church. And if you missed the story, you go back and watch the first hour. But now we want to see if we have any questions. Mm-hmm. Deacon Flowers had a comment.
Yes.
Go ahead, Deacon Flowers. Nice,
yes,
and loud.
Yes, Pastor, I had a comment.
Can you hear Deacon Flowers?
Yeah.
Because this study made me think about when I was coming up, how my mother would have the members from the Kingdom Hall, the elder and some of the Bethelites, we call them, that came from different cities, and open up the table and feed them. And I always wondered, you know, we don't have a whole lot. How are you doing this? She said, God has been good to me, and I'm going to be good to God by helping his people. So take away that selfishness and show hospitality to our guest. And it's, you have to learn this at home. You
right.
have to learn it at home.
Right.
So she taught me from a young man or a young child what it is to be hospitable.
Right.
It wind up happening month after month. We kept doing this. And so I felt good about it after a while and developed good relationships with the members of the church.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, if we, in our churches, you know, people would show hospitality in so many ways,
mm-hmm.
you know, but if you just think about what churches do, I was thinking about when I was in seminary, mm-hmm. I was lonely my first year. I didn't know many people in New York City.
Okay.
And, three churches really helped me. St. Luke AME, mm. down on 135th in Harlem.
In Harlem, yeah.
Yeah. St. John Baptist, I don't even remember the address, in Salem United Methodist, mm. on 129th and 7th.
Okay.
All of those people after church would reach out.
Mm.
And I desperately needed somebody to reach out.
Okay.
I really needed that.
Yes.
And they all had dinner.
Yes.
After church.
Yeah.
And one of the things about hospitality is making food for people. I've never really understood that till I've been home more.
Okay.
And I've had occasion to make dinner for somebody. And when you make food for somebody you love, it's an act of love.
Yes.
As you well know, mm-hmm. you know, Dick Flowers is a master cook. Some of the stuff he cook, I don't eat. Him and Deacon Aldridge make oxtails. I don't eat that stuff. But they was bragging about how good their oxtails were. But you know that when you love somebody mm-hmm. and you give them that food, it's a ministry.
Yes.
You know, and so, yeah, the churches have been known to be hospitable.
Yes.
And one of the things in Black history, around, really started in World War I, around 1919, Black people came up from the South to the North,
mm-hmm.
and it continued even after World War II to the 1940s. It's called the Great Migration.
Right.
It displaced the population till in the 70s and early 80s, 70% of Black people were in the North. It's being reversed now. A lot of Black people are going back South. But in the 70s, there was that trend.
Mm-hmm.
And when they came, they were on the train and the buses with brown bags of chicken You ask some older person about that. But one of the first things that they did was they were given hospitality, because a lot of them were like my grandmother's family. I'm told that my Uncle Roy and his brother, I think of his name in a second, they brought a lot of the family up.
Mm-hmm.
And they had to stay together. They had to be crammed in the, you know, tight living quarters, mm-hmm. Until they could get somewhere. And so you had to show hospitality to them. A lot of Christians say that when people flee their country and come to the United States, we ought to be showing hospitality. Now other people say, well, you know, they're not citizens. They can't come and get everything from us. And I understand both sides.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but I do know that it is a good effort to show hospitality to the stranger.
Yes.
Okay. When African Americans came to this country, we weren't shown hospitality. We were first indentured servants and then enslaved.
Right.
And so the fact that we were freed from enslavement, but we were still bound by segregation until the 1960s. So we had to be hospitable to each other. And even in biblical times, there's another scripture about what a true widow is, and it says it's one who washes the saints' feet. Because if you got on the road in ancient times and you walked, your feet were dusty. Even if you had sandals, you were walking on the road, your feet were dusty.
Mm-hmm.
And the act of hospitality was to wash someone's feet.
Amen.
And we saw this, our Lord, what did the Lord do the night before he was betrayed? He washed the disciples' feet. All right. He was showing the hospitality. He was showing the love. They weren't even strangers. He was just showing the love.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. After the meal. All right. So this is what the Lord calls us to do. And sometimes, you know, people can be very rude, very, very hurtful. But we have to distinguish between a Christian response and a worldly response. Some of you might have seen on the news the man who was driving, and he got in some kind of conflict. I believe he was in Miami, and they threw a water bottle at his car, and he had a gun, and he shot through his own window,
mm-hmm.
and which is crazy because, you know, you're not worried about glass getting in your eyes. He didn't have on a hat. He didn't have on glasses. He shot through his own window, and thank God he didn't really hit anything. Couldn't shoot. But our times are the exact opposite of hospitality. They are times of hostility. And you say, what is the opposite of hospitable? Hostile. Okay? No love. The hatred of strangers. The resentment of strangers. That's what hostility is. That's the kind of time that we in. But God is not calling us to that. God is calling us to be hospitable. All right? So, do I have any questions from the
What are the strengths of being hospitable?
Strengths.
What are the strengths
mm-hmm.
of being hospitable? Well, number one, in order for you to share the love of God, you got to let the love of God in. And when God uses you to do something, he works it through you. So if God uses you to show other people God's love, the love comes through you. So the first strength is that the love comes through you. Okay? And when there's just a blessing and the love coming through you.
Mm-hmm.
All right. By the time I preach on Sunday, I've dealt with the sermon 3 or 4 times. But the blessing is, it's still coming through me. And every time it comes through me, there's a blessing. When the power of God comes through you,
mm-hmm.
there is always a blessing.
Amen.
And so the first strength is when you're hospitable, you open yourself up to the Holy Spirit to lead you in ways that you didn't know. Remember what Jesus said. This is my theme for 2020. Okay. So it is with everyone who was born of the Spirit. Jesus was lecturing Nicodemus on what it meant to be born spiritually, to have a spiritual experience, what all of us are supposed to have. Not just church attendance,
mm-hmm.
not just sitting on a pew, but an inner experience with the Spirit of the living God. And when we have that experience, Jesus told Nicodemus, the wind, you become like the wind. You don't know where the wind came from. You don't know where the wind is going. And so when you become filled with the Spirit, when you become spiritual, you don't always know where your orders come from. You don't know where your order is going to take you. But you know where your orders tell you to go. Now, when the Spirit comes through you to do something, the power of the Lord can't come through you without blessing you first. You're going to be blessed. Even when it goes out of you, you're still blessed.
Amen.
The woman that touched, the woman had the issue of blood, touched Jesus, she got healed. But Jesus said, who touched me? They said, everybody touched you. He said, no, the power came out of me.
Mm-hmm.
The power came out. Something happened.
Yes.
Okay. And so when you are hospitable, you experience in the Spirit the power of God coming through you. When you are hospitable, you experience the love of God coming through you. All right? That's the first thing. The second thing is, you get a chance to bless people. It's nothing like people coming to you, letting you know that your faithfulness has blessed them. Now, we don't want people to start praising us, but it's a great blessing. When Deacon Flowers preached, I gave this example early, and we were walking back. People were so thankful. They were saying, thank you, Pastor Flowers. Thank you. He kept saying, no. And I was like, stop. Stop saying that. Just tell them. Just be gracious.
Yes.
Be hospitable. Just say thank you.
Mm-hmm.
We correct them later.
Mm-hmm.
If they go somewhere and they say, Pastor Flowers is the head of the church at Open Door, then you can correct it. Okay. But they were enjoying the fact that they had a man in their building
mm-hmm.
that could come on the other side of town and preach a funeral.
Yeah.
That's the key.
Yes.
That's the key. All right. I enjoyed the fact that those white people who were scared of black people, not used to black people, maybe some of them didn't like black people because some of them left and didn't say nothing to me. But I love the fact that the power of God put us on one accord. We didn't start out on one accord, but that's where we ended up. So another strength is you see God move in ways that you didn't think. You didn't know it was going to be like that. I've seen God, last year, I seen God do some tremendous things. I seen God move stones out of my heart. I seen God reconcile me with people I never thought I'd be reconciled with. I've seen God work miraculous things. Okay, now there were tragedies, there were hurts. We all know those. But by being hospitable, I seen God do stuff that is just mind-blowing.
Mm-hmm.
And when you're hospitable, you don't know where the Spirit orders came from. You don't know where the Spirit orders are going to take you. But you know in the end, you're going to be blessed.
That's right.
Because you will have done the will of God.
Mm.
And so strangers become friends. Strangers become Christians. We've had Deacon Grant counseled somebody. Who was it he counseled? And Deacon Aldridge was in the mix somehow. But he wasn't a deacon. He was just Jimmy Aldridge.
Mm.
And by Deacon Grant counseling whoever he counseled, Jimmy Aldridge joined the church.
Mm.
And later on, Jimmy Aldridge became Deacon Aldridge. You never know what's going to happen, all right? You never know who you're going to touch. You never know how you're going to touch. Do you have any other questions?
No, but I have a comment.
Yes. We were joking with Sister Richardson. She always says she never has a question until she get warmed up.
Okay, so just with hearing everything, it just had my mind flowing.
I told you that would happen.
So, okay, first and foremost, I want to thank you, and I want to thank my godmother, because you are the two most important people, outside of my parents, you are the two most important people in my life, and that is where I now have my own apartment, and now when I have guests over, I want to be hospitable, and it's one thing to just have to learn it and have to force yourself to do it. It's another thing to have that in you, and you want to be that way. You mm-hmm. want people to enjoy themselves when they're around you. You want to go into someone else's space or be out with people and have them feel just good to have you around or in their space or vice versa. And I was also just thinking about why I have that in me. And two things really quickly. I remember when we had Bible study the first time at your house. No, not Bible study. You fellowship for the first time at your house. And you were just like, y'all want a tour? Y'all want to look around? Y'all want to go? It was just kind of like homey. It made us feel welcome. It made us feel like we weren't just in Pastor Taylor's house. It felt like we were in a homey space, a safe space. That made us feel welcome. And then I was also just thinking about my godmother, who I've lived with for almost more than half my life, and just to be in a new space that isn't necessarily your primary home, but to still have that same feeling and to be able to bring people into your home and allow them to feel loved, allow them to feel safe, and then to teach them about God, to teach them about different things. It changed my entire life. Me living with her, me being in your house at Bible studies and youth fellowships, and just being in the church, and the church having that hospitable spirit changed my entire outlook on life, changed the way I want to live, changed the way I think when people come into my home and into my space. So it's almost like a watering fountain that just keeps going when you are showing hospitality to people, because you don't know what that's going to bring up out of them as they grow. Mm-hmm. That's all.
Amen. No, that's a great one. That's you are flowing, right? That's a great testimony, because what it did was it showed you the truth of the word before you even knew what was in the word. Okay, and that's something that I think when you're hospitable, because remember, church didn't start in buildings.
Right.
Churches started in people's homes.
Right.
It started in public squares. It started in people, you know, preaching in the synagogue, but taking it to the homes. The earliest churches were like Lydia. Lydia told Paul, she said, if you think I'm a woman of God, come to my house. And they had churches in the home. So the church has to be in the home.
Yes.
That church has to be in your home. Don't let the TV take over your home. Don't let the screen take over your home. Cut it off sometime. Put the gospel music on. And if you got the screen on, put a preach on. Put a choir on. Okay, because the church needs to be the center of your home. Okay, because in the hospitality, in obeying the word, the homes have always been open. The youth fellowship was built because we went around in different people's homes. Now, we went to somebody's home and they tore up something, and the word got out that if Reverend Taylor bring the youth, they're going to tear up something. I didn't even know what happened, but a lot of the doors were closed. But back in the day, when I came here for years, me and Deacon Brickhouse, we ran youth fellowship in people's homes. And a lot of the church's greatest, success stories, because not all of our stories are success, but most of them are, but a lot of our greatest success stories are young people who we took to different people's homes. And they saw certain things. When I was about 10 and 11, I went to my uncle, Reverend James F. Jordan, and asked him, could I come and spend the weekend in his house? And my mother and he, they talked about it till he died. Because he was like, he repeated, he said, you want to come and spend the night in my house? And then he said, well, why? And I said, I just want to see where you live. I was so enamored with the men of God in my life, I wanted to go to their house. I'm nosy. I was in somebody's house the other day. She said, you want a tour? I said, I want to see everything. Okay, and I did. Because there's something about us. I think a lot of us want to see it all. Yes. I just admit it. Mm-hmm. Okay. But what I found in my uncle's house was what I expected. I found the sense of the holy. It was something holy in his house. It was a spirit in his house that I knew would be there.
Yes.
And it affected me very deeply.
Amen.
And when you as a believer, if your house is dedicated to God and you bring people in it, your being in the space does something that words can't do. It's beyond words. And so every minister I've known was hospitable. And every minister I've known. Was hospitable. Let you come in their car.
Yeah.
Let you come in their house. I remember one time I went to Faith Temple Church of God in Christ, and we went to a guest church, and then we went out to eat This is part of hospitality. Mm-hmm. And I love to go to eat because I was in college. I didn't have a lot of money, and Bishop Moody was paying for everybody. Mm-hmm. He would pay for everybody. And so we were leaving. And so he said to me, he said, son, I got to go do something. He said, take my wife's little car and drive it somewhere. His wife had a Mercedes. Wasn't that a little? And it was the first time I drove a Mercedes.
Yes, yes.
I was kind of nervous, but he had already told me, because we went, this is what hospitality does. By being hospitable, he taught me a lot of stuff. In the Bible, there was an Eastern concept of teaching. In the West, we have a concept of you come in the classroom mm-hmm. and I tell you something. In the East, they have a concept of this is the master, you go live with him. Mm-hmm. And while you're living with him, you learn right. something. You see this in Kung Fu movies.
Yes.
You know, even if you see Kill Bill, mm-hmm. they went to live with right. the teacher, who, you know, who was the Kung Fu teacher. I mean, right. you see this. Well, Jesus, being an Eastern man, his disciples lived with him.
Yes.
And when you're around somebody, that's when you learn a lot of your deepest lessons.
Yes.
Okay? So one of the things, I was with Bishop Moody, and he had a light blue Lincoln Town car. Mm-hmm. I mean, the kind with the big wheel in the back.
Yeah.
Some
yeah,
of y'all know that. Oh, that big, that long. You know what I'm talking about, Deacon Clark. We went in this hood neighborhood
yeah.
to Bishop Goldsberry's church. And two things I'll never forget. Number one, we went in there, and Bishop Moody didn't hoop. He hooped them people to the hair, fell off, the wigs fell off. The weaves came out.
Yes, yes.
All right, the rings fell off. And I never heard him hooping. He was hooping. I was like, oh my God, he don't do this. Second thing, though, is when we got out, I knew it was a rough neighborhood because my grandmother lived down the street. And every time we came over there, somebody broke in our car. Mm. And I said, his elder, and I said, Elder Moody, are you worried about your car? He said, son, it's a piece of metal. Mm-hmm. Somebody take it, I'm going to give me another piece of metal.
Okay.
He said, I got work to do. That was one of the deepest things anybody ever said to me. He had mm-hmm. this big, fine car. He said, I don't care. What I care about is my work.
Yes.
And so many things. I could tell you hundreds of stories. Because mm-hmm. I used to go home with him mm-hmm. and eat. And you know, when he would go home, they would bring the food. He's like a king. They'd bring the food. And I would ask him questions. All his sons would go off, and the other people would go in another room and listen. They would ask him, do you want this, Bishop? He would say, no, no, no. He would answer all of my questions. He showed me that. And then we would go to church.
Amen.
Then it was somebody from the church, most of the time him. This is the thing. We would go to church, we would stay there, and Bishop Moody would say, son, I'll take you home. He had other people. He had a church full of people that take me home, including his children. He would say, son, I'll take you home. He would tell his wife to go home. Mm-hmm. You have somebody take his wife home. And he would drive me home himself. And a lot of things that I learned about being a pastor and being a man of God and being holy and being righteous, I learned when we was on the way home. Because when we would go home, he wouldn't just say, okay, son, get out. I preach. He would say, what are you going to ask me tonight? Mm-hmm. And sure enough, and you know what? I was asking him to learn, but also I was lonely. I missed my family. Mm-hmm. And he became like my family.
Amen.
And he knew it. I realized this much later. He knew it. He knew I was lonely. Mm-hmm. He knew I was trying to live safe. He knew I was struggling. And he sat outside my dorm room for an hour answering my questions. And I know his wife said, why are you always driving that boy home? Let somebody else drive him home. He said, son, I'll take you home. That's the hospitality. But what does that produce?
Yeah.
That produces everything you've seen me do.
That's it.
Yeah. Everything you've seen me do.
Yes.
Is tied up in that.
Amen.
Larry Hawkins would say, go in my office and find such and such. His office was junky. I'd be in his office for hours looking for stuff. And a lot of stuff he'd tell me, fine. Man, it might not even been in there. So he would come in late and say, did you find it? I would say, I looked everywhere. I didn't find it. He said, that's all right. And then we'd sit up and have our talk. And I would ask him 100 questions. And he would just sit there. And a lot of stuff that I learned about working with groups, I put this on Facebook. I learned because he would just sit with me and talk to me. That's hospitality.
Yeah.
And so one of the things that we should be concerned about now is how to develop the next generation. You have to do it by being hospitable. Taking them out to dinner, mm-hmm. taking them to the ball game, sitting, talking to people, letting people ask you questions. One time, we was going home from church, somebody came and started asking me something. My mother was like, where are we going home? But she knew. I said, as soon as I finished talking, Mom, we're going home. She knew. You have to do that. You have to be hospitable. As a little girl, Reverend Claude and Reverend Addie Wyatt from the Vernon Park Church of God took her to California. She saw things she never would have seen as a young girl from the projects in the south side of Chicago. Mm. She saw California. And the trip and the kindness of Reverend Claude and Reverend Addie Wyatt stayed with her. And so when we wanted to go to Philadelphia, they wanted to put us on a, my father was saying, take a Greyhound bus. She was like, no, my children are going on the train. Mm-hmm. And we went on the train so we could look out the window and see stuff.
Amen.
So you're absolutely right. When you sow seeds, you reap what you sow, and you lead somebody else to sow seeds.
That's right.
And it makes a difference. It's how the Lord blesses things. That's why in this COVID time, one of the things I want everybody to do, reach out more. Mm-hmm. Reach out more. You get tired of reaching out. You get burned sometimes reaching out. But reach out more. And God will always bless you. I had a friend of mine. How much time I got?
2 minutes.
I had a friend of mine. I hadn't talked to her for 2 years. And she called me. She said, why are you ignoring me? I said, because every time you call me, you want to talk about your boyfriend. Her boyfriend was a preacher here in Brooklyn. And I said, I got tired of watching you throw yourself at this guy who didn't care nothing about you. Mm-hmm. She said, why you didn't say that? I said it 10 times. Mm-hmm. You didn't hear me. Mm-hmm. I said it a whole lot. Mm-hmm. And I reminded her, I took her, he was supposed to meet us somewhere, and I took her, and he didn't show up. We stayed there 45 minutes. Then I brought her back, we stopped by the church, then he called an hour and a half after the 45 minutes mm-hmm. to make an excuse. And so we had to reconcile. It was really good. Mm-hmm. It was really good, you know. But by staying on that phone, and by her being hospitable, because she kept calling, she said, "I knew you was ignoring me. I want to find out why." And I said, "Well, I didn't feel like I was ignoring you. I just didn't want to deal with that drama anymore, because you wasn't listening to me. I can only watch people beat themselves up so much." Hospitality is not always weak now. Because mm-hmm. everybody you invite in your house, they ain't going to know to let the toilet seat down. Mm-hmm. Some of them going to be dirty. They might mess up your house. Mm-hmm. They might break your house. But that's all part of the ministry.
Yes, that's right.
All right?
Amen.
All right? Okay. Yes. If you didn't give offering, go to TCO, TLDGIVIN, give on Cash App Wednesday night offering. Go to TCO, TLD.org and go into the giving portal and give. Yes, put my man up there. All right? But don't ever stop giving. Don't ever stop being hospitable. But listen, and I'm going to talk more about this next week. Be wise in your hospitality. Mm-hmm. Understand. The wolf sometimes put on sheep's clothes. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Being hospitable don't mean being unwise or stupid. Mm-hmm.
That's right.
Jesus said, love your enemy, but he said, love your neighbor as yourself. Right. Your enemy is not your neighbor.
Mm-hmm.
Get this. Get this. Mm-hmm. Be wise. Be wise as what? Not a dove. Be wise as a serpent. Understand snakes and treacherous people. Killers. Be wise. Okay? Just because you hospitable, don't bring everybody in your house.
Right.
I was looking at a picture before I came here of some people going off in an Airbnb. Mm-hmm. And it was a comedian, Shula King. Mm-hmm. You know comedians. You know him. He was saying, there goes the deposit. Because they were tearing this house up. Mm-hmm. Now, not everybody come to your house to tear it up, but if you rent your house to some people in an Airbnb, they're Negroes. They don't do nothing but tear up stuff. Mm-hmm. They never had nothing nice. They just got some money. So they can't keep what you got that's nice. So you got to be wise in your hospitality. Okay. And then you got to watch the person, and when you invite them in, they never want to leave. Be wise. Mm-hmm. All right. Sharon Kennedy is here. Reverend McDonald is here. The one and only Reverend Joyce McDonald. Hallelujah. Deacon Brick House, Deacon Doris B. Dakota Barnes is here. Sister Moore, Christine Caraway. Deacon Page is here. Tijuana Wiggins, Joy White. Legacy of the great Phoebe White. Sister Kearney is here. Brother Douglas. Siobhan Stevens is here. And Cynthia Bright. Thank you all for hanging out. Listen, we become the people who are the teachers and the shapers of the future. And when we learn the word of God and learn it deep down in our hearts. So thank you all for coming in this repast. Thank you, Deacon Flowers, yes. Sister Richardson, for your questions. Very great. And we're going to sign off. Sunday, meet us here at 11:30.
Sunday.
It's first Sunday, so Saturday we'll be giving out communion.
Yes.
Saturday, what time?
1 to 4.
1 to 4, we'll be giving out communion. The kitchen, the food line opens up. The pantry.
Yes. They should. They didn't do it last week because of the weather.
They didn't do it last week because of the weather. So yeah, that was wise. Right. So they should be at what time? Are they 10 to 12.
10 to 12.
10 to 12. 1 to 4 is the communion. Mm-hmm. So come out, get your communion kit. And we're going to have a great month. This is 2222. Do something today beautiful. Do something wonderful. You still got a couple hours. Do something important today because this is a great day. All right? Amen. Father God, thank you for allowing us to be here. Thank you for overflowing in wisdom and knowledge and love and hospitality. Give us to know that you were hospitable to us because while we were yet sinners, Christ loved us. And help us to be hospitable no matter how people treat us so that we might by all means win some. In the name above every name, the mighty and the matchless name of the Lord Jesus, we pray. God's people say, amen.
Amen.
All right, we're going out with my main man, Brother Dietrich Haddon.